Hi, and welcome to this tutorial in which you will learn how to easily create stunning halftone patterns using your own custom line work and images. First, I'll briefly cover the basic theory needed to understand how the process works. Then, I'll quickly show you how to create a few suitable line-based patterns in Adobe Illustrator. And lastly, I'll go through the whole process in Adobe Photoshop and give a few tips on how the final artwork can be stylized. Let's get started. Okay, so to generate linear halftones, it's easiest to use parallel or perpendicular lines because they make it simple to ensure that your line work is evenly spaced. If you want to create a dot halftone, you should explore overlapping your line work. I find this technique works particularly well with lines spaced by 3 times their thickness that are blurred by half their thickness. Now, I'm a firm believer in letting the software do all the hard work, so I'll show you how to do this without reaching for a calculator. To generate this effect, your layer stack in Photoshop should look as follows. The threshold adjustment filter is the real MVP here, so stick around for a quick deep dive into that tool if you want a comprehensive understanding of why this process works. Timestamps are in the description if you want to skip ahead and start creating. To demonstrate how the threshold adjustment filter works, I will add a gradient adjustment layer at 0 degrees, which runs from black to white. As shown on the histogram, this will create a range of values from 100% black through 50% grey and all the way to 100% white. If I now add a threshold adjustment layer, it will convert the range of values that was generated by the gradient into either 100% black or 100% white, depending on their value. I'll quickly mask out part of the threshold layer. Now you can see both the gradient and the effect that the threshold is having on it. The threshold has its own histogram showing the range of values of our gradient mapped out with the darkest on the left and the brightest on the right. Values to the left of the slider will appear black and values to the right will appear white. I'll add an ellipse and change its color to black. Because it's already 100% black, the threshold will have no effect on the ellipse. However, adding a Gaussian blur to the ellipse will create a range of values around it, similar to that generated by the gradient. Now that the threshold has additional values to interact with, you can see that it has an impact on the ellipse. If I remove the mask, you can see how the threshold works when multiple ranges of values intersect. Changing the slider on the threshold now reveals that there are points at which the gradient and ellipse appear to deform and pull towards each other. It's this deformation that we will exploit in this tutorial. I've started up Adobe Illustrator with a 1080 by 1350 artboard. To help ensure that my line work is equally spaced, I'll set up a 27 pixel grid as this spacing works perfectly with my artboard size. To utilize the grid, we need to go up to View and select Show Grid. Then go back up to View and ensure that no other snap is active except for Snap to Grid. Let's start by making a basic horizontal pattern. Activate the line tool and use Shift to constrain it to a horizontal axis. Hold Alt with the down cursor key to continuously duplicate the line to the bottom of the artboard. Select everything and set the stroke weight to 27.4/3 to ensure that the line is as third as thick as our grid spacing. Now let's make a simple wavy pattern. Draw a line that is 2 grid units from the top of the artboard and the same at the bottom. Select both lines and go to Effect, Distort and Transform, and select Zigzag. Change the size to match the grid units. Set the number of ridges to 10, and select Smooth Points. Use Ctrl, Alt, and B to create a blend between the two lines. By double-clicking the Blend tool, we can change the blend spacing to specified steps and adjust their number to around 40. To add a letterform into your design, activate the Type tool, type a letter, and use Ctrl, Shift, and O to convert it to an outline. Resize the letterform to fill most of the artboard, making sure to constrain its proportions as you do so. Once in place, half its opacity and ensure that it's on its own locked layer. As before, generate a series of horizontal lines that cover the full extent of the letterform. Using the direct selection tool, select endpoints of the lines and use the cursor keys to nudge them so they align with the letterform. It's much more important here to make a consistent pattern than match the letterform perfectly. Once complete, hide the original letterform and add a series of vertical lines over the top. Make sure you select everything and adjust the stroke weight as before. To incorporate some typography into the line work, activate the type tool, type out a word, convert it to outlines, and resize it so that it sits just up from the bottom of the artboard. Give it a stroke and copy the text to another layer, ensuring to use Ctrl, Shift and V to paste it in place. With only the new layer visible, go to Window and bring up the Actions panel. To set up an action that will allow us to easily offset a path multiple times, we'll click New Action, give it a suitable name, and set the function key to F2. After clicking Record, go to Object, Path, and Offset Path, ensuring that the offset value is the same as the grid spacing. Click the stop icon to complete the recording of the action. We now need to double-click the text and delete the original letters, leaving only the offset paths. Once complete, select all the paths and click Unite on the Pathfinder panel. With the new path selected, we can hold our specified function key to repeatedly play the action. Draw a rectangle one grid unit in from the artboard, select everything, and make a clipping mask with Ctrl and 7 to remove any line work that extends past the artboard. Unhide the original text and ensure everything has the correct stroke weight. Holding the left mouse button on the line tool will reveal the polar grid tool. Select it and click once on the artboard to bring up its dialog box. Set the width and height to the grid spacing units multiplied by 102 by entering 27*102. We only want concentric circles, so set the number of concentric dividers to 50 and the number of radial dividers to 0. Then use the direct selection tool to highlight the bottom point of all the circles and hit delete. Use O to activate the reflect tool, click where the center of the circles used to be, and drag whilst holding Shift and Alt to duplicate and reflect the line work at the same time. Go up to Object, Transform, and then Move to displace the line work horizontally by 25 times the grid units by typing 27*25. I decided to select and group the artwork and use the selection tool with Shift to rotate it 90 degrees. I then centered it on the artboard in both the X and Y directions. Finally, make a clipping mask of the artwork and adjust the stroke weight as before. Before copying any artwork into Photoshop that has an active clipping mask, it's best to prepare it first by going up to Object and Rasterize and then selecting Transparent as the background. Right, let's finish this up in Photoshop. I've set up a 1080 by 1350 canvas at 72 dpi using RGB color mode. If you want a smoother result or if you're designing for print, it's best to increase the dpi. But in any scenario, start with an RGB color mode as it provides a good range of values between black and white. I've already dragged in this wonderful portrait by Sam Burris from unsplash.com. There's a link in the description if you want to use it to follow along. Also, I've already copied the basic horizontal line work from Illustrator to my clipboard. Let's start by resizing and positioning the portrait and then put in a curves adjustment layer above it. Although the curves can be used to boost the contrast of an image, starting with one that already has vivid contrast, forms a silhouette, or has strong shadows or highlights works best. Above the image layer, paste in the line work as a smart object and hit enter to confirm its position. To complete the basic layer stack, add the threshold adjustment layer at the top. Setting the threshold to 100 works in this instance, but it may need to be adjusted slightly depending on your artwork and image. I'll turn that off for now so you can see the rest of the process clearly. Select the line work and go to Filter, Blur, and then Gaussian Blur. Because we need the blur to be half the stroke weight, which is already a third of the grid unit, we can use the grid unit divided by 6. To achieve this, simply type 27/6. Adjust the two handles of the curves adjustment layer to approximately the position shown. This will subdue the most intense black and white values in the image, boost the contrast slightly, and ensure that the line work has the darkest value on the canvas. Select the image and add a Gaussian blur. If your image is a smart object, you can adjust this value later. For now, set it to something where the image is still easily identifiable with the blur added. If we reactivate the threshold adjustment layer, the halftone starts to emerge. Now it's a case of balancing the handles on the curves layer. Adjusting the left handle vertically adjusts the thicker parts of the lines, whereas adjusting the right handle vertically affects the thinner parts of the lines. Moving either handle horizontally will affect how the thin and thick parts of the lines taper into each other. Be careful not to move them too close on the horizontal axis, as this will remove the taper altogether and nullify the effect we're aiming for. Adding a layer between the image and the curves layer will allow us to brush out parts of the original image. With the brush tool active, painting in black will add to the thicker part of the line, and painting in white will subtract from it. I'll make a couple of small adjustments. You may want to use a soft brush or add a blur to your brushwork if it results in hard edges. I've already pasted in the remaining line works from Illustrator and will copy the blur from the layer above by holding Alt before dragging it onto each layer. Once done, I'll swap the layer visibility to the next line work. As you can see, this one's working perfectly well out of the box, so we'll move on. Now, because our wavy line work doesn't have precisely equal spacing, the effect doesn't work quite as well. Adjusting the curves only goes some way to rectifying this. In this situation, I would suggest swapping the image for a silhouette or a letterform or anything that has a much less complex shape. I'll quickly add an ampersand, give it a blur, and adjust the curves. If you want greater accuracy here, you can use the cursor keys to nudge the curve's handles. I'll reactivate the image and swap over to the line work that we generated by offsetting type. This one works slightly better because the differences in spacing between the lines is less extreme. However, I find the variation in thickness around the typography a little inconsistent. I'll use the brush tool to quickly remove the thicker lines from this area. Next, I'll deactivate the brush layer and swap over to the letterform line work. Although this one works immediately, I would suggest avoiding any drastic changes in line work direction over an important detail of the underlying image, such as a face. To quickly rectify this, I will use Ctrl and T to move the image so that the model's face is not obscured by the change in halftone style. Note that by adjusting the left curves handle, we can also change the aperture of the dot halftones. I'll end this tutorial by showing some ways in which these halftones can be stylized. I've already merged down all but one of the results. I did this by creating a new layer and using Alt, Shift, Control, and E to merge the visible layers to this new layer. Before I move on, it's quickly worth mentioning that you can use multiple sets of line work to create some interesting results. I'll keep my live layers in a deactivated group in case I want to adjust them later. I think optical art looks great in simple black and white form, so I'll leave this one exactly as it is. With the type-generated line work, we can duplicate the artwork with Ctrl and J and add a 2-pixel blur to the copy of the layer. Then set the blend mode of this layer to Difference. Next, create a new layer and merge down the artwork as before. Finally, hide the previously copied layer and change the blend mode of the merge layer to Vivid Light. I'll merge down these three layers into a single layer. For our wavy line work, we can add a gradient overlay adjustment layer to replace the black and white with something altogether more colourful. Again, I'll merge these down into a single layer. I like this one as is, but I will adopt a pixel stretch technique to change things up a little. Hold the left mouse button over the marquee tool to find the single row marquee tool. With this selected, click on part of the image, press Ctrl and T for transform, and drag the top of the selection whilst holding Shift. I'll do the same at the bottom. For the final artwork, we can go up to Filter and then Liquify. Use the Forward Warp tool to liquefy one side of the image. Note that it's best to avoid doing this on any part of the artwork that is important for the underlying image to remain discernible. Take a little time with this and have some fun. And there we have it. I hope you see the potential of this process and find new ways to use it in your work. I'd love to see what you make from it, so feel free to tag me on social media if you post your artwork online. Like, comment, and subscribe for more, and I will see you in the next one.